Hey, I can't see that clock. I went to the doctor the other day, and I told the doctor, he said, what's your problem? I said, well, I can't see the small print on my television, and I sat 10 feet across the room from it. He said, sounds to me like you need to get a bigger television. So if you want me to see that clock, you need to get a bigger clock. I said, Doctor, I got a 27-inch. He said, well, I got a 52-inch. I thought, yeah, and I'm helping you pay for it. But the Bible said you shall receive power. And let me tell you, folks, we need the power of God in our lives. I'm serious this morning. If I've ever felt anything in my life, folks, I believe if we knew what was coming down the pike concerning the Christian and the church, this world's in a heap of trouble. And we're going to face things that we never thought we'd ever face before. And we're going to need God. And we're going to need the hand of God. We're going to need the power of the Spirit to be able to make us to stand in the evil time that is upon us. Amen. But sometimes we limit the power of the Spirit. But there's no limit to God's power. As a Christian, folks, I'm telling you, we see that there is a chance that there's persecution coming to the church. They're trying to do everything they can. We got a government now that is so confused they don't know what's going on. And we got a leader now that is not really for the church. Things could get very bad. But I believe that if we knew what was coming, we'd be on our face before God. The preacher wouldn't have to beg for somebody to come and pray at prayer meeting time. Amen. We would come and pray before service, after service, and in between times. If we just seek God, that God would give us a renewing of the Holy Ghost and power that we might be able to stand. Amen. The early Christians tarried in the upper room and waited for God's power. Different commentators varied to how many there was actually there before they went into the upper room, but there was 120 that stayed there in the upper room until God came down and began to minister to them and filled them with the Holy Ghost, and they began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And now I'm not preaching on tongues, but I want to tell you something. A lot of people worry about speaking in tongues. Don't worry about speaking in tongues. When God fills you with the Holy Ghost, they're going to come automatically. And don't worry about what you're going to say, because speaking in tongues is not just an ordinary language. Somebody said that it's a language that spoke somewhere across the world somewhere. I don't really agree with that, because I believe that God in heaven is the only one that understands. And when you're praying in the Spirit, my friend, you're praying directly to the Father. Amen. And the Father, the Spirit is making intercession for you and will enable you to touch the throne of God. Paul told the church in Ephesus, finally, my brother, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Folks, I'm telling you, the devil's busy today. He works on your mind. He works on your body. You know, speaking of work on your mind, I had peace about that cancer that I had and knew that God was going to take care of it, But then the old devil jumped on my back and began to say to me, every time I'd shut my eyes, he'd say, when you go to that surgery, you're not going to wake up. And so this song came that I read to you came to my mind. Amen. And Brother Walls and Brother Calhoun came in to pray with me before, and my wife, my family, before they took me to surgery. And on the way to surgery, I was singing. And the young man said, what'd you say? I said, I'm just talking to the Lord. Amen. And I was saying, Lord, if I've wounded some poor soul today, if I've caused one foot to go astray, if I've walked in my own willful way, dear Lord, forgive. Because, folks, I don't know about you, but I want to have the power of God in my life that I may be able to stand until we go to be with Him, and I can hear Him say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Amen. Hallelujah. Paul wanted the church at Ephesus to be strong in the Lord. He wanted them to stand. And I believe here that the armor of God that he talks about, the power of his might, represents the power of the Holy Ghost. Amen. We're talking about Pentecost. I know that Pentecost it simply means 50, and it's 50 days after the Passover. But I think it's ironic that God chose the day, 50-day, the Pentecost day to send the Holy Ghost. And so we just call the Holy Ghost Pentecostal. Amen. I'm not ashamed that I'm Pentecostal. Are you? But you shall receive power to enable you to stand. He said, don't take any thought what you'll say when you stand before the kings and the judges and so on. Folks, we have the power to be able to stand against all anything the devil brings our way. If he brings thoughts our way that shouldn't be, we have power to say, get thee behind me, Satan. If he brings trouble in our way, somebody come in and jump on you, amen, like a chicken on a June bug, and start telling you what for. You know, I had a lady call me up one time. Well, I've had several of those, but she was unhappy about something. And she began to blame me for something. And she began to talk to me in languages that I hadn't heard in a long time. And I said, lady, I don't have time to listen to this kind of junk. If you want to talk to me and talk to me decent, we'll talk. But otherwise, bye. That's the benefit of telephones. But anyway, I've had people come to me and get on me and try to do all kinds of things. But I want you to know something. God gives us power to be able to stand against any attacks the devil will bring our way. I said that to say this. The second point I want you to know, Acts 1 and 8 said, and ye shall be witnesses unto me. We're his witness. It's our work to be his witness. And you know what the best witness is? The life that you live. Everywhere you go, somebody is reading your life. Somebody knows your life. Amen? I tell you, folks, you just never know who may be watching you. Amen? I've had people come to me on the job, or I was at a service station one time, and I was putting gas in my car, and this man walked up to me, and he said, you're a preacher, aren't you? I said, yes, sir. He said, I just knew it by the way you looked. And I thought, oh God, help me that I always look the way that I can represent the Lord. And people will know Amen. I believe that we all be such a strong witness for God that if a mosquito bites you, he ought to fly away saying there's power in the blood. Amen. I tell you, folks, the time is short, and it's time for you and I to reach the lost. There's folks out there that's lost and dying and on their way to hell, and it's up to you and I to witness to them and reach the lost. Well, Brother Long, I don't know what to say. Don't worry about what you're going to say. Just be willing and obedient. And when you get there, God will give you what to say. Amen. But most of all, number one, live the life before Him. Number two, amen, you can just begin to tell Him what the Lord has done for you. You know? And there's a... Of course, over the years, I've had all kinds of experiences, but I've always been able to find an experience in my life to where I could begin to talk to somebody and tell them what the Lord had done for me. Amen. I tell you, I think it's a sad thing we have let the upper room experience gather dust, and we have forgotten about what our mission is. We're doing the very best that we can. It's quite a sacrifice for us to come to church on Sunday. But oh, folks, I want you to know something. God knows. I thought as I walked out of the door this morning, I didn't see a neighbor nowhere. But I thought that somebody, it just felt like somebody was watching me. And I said, oh, Lord, help me that they know that when Sunday morning comes, I'm going to church. When the service time comes, I'm going to church. Amen. And I want people to know the power of God in my life. Hallelujah. There was a time that we would pray and seek God He would stir our hearts and stir us up and get us out of the complacency. Oh, I'm meddling now. It's awful easy when things are going good, you know. And they everything's going smoothly. We just cross our arms and lay back and relax and just enjoy things. Amen. But I want you to know something. It's time that we get out of our complacency. It's time that we rise up and begin to stand, and we begin to be an army for the Lord and begin to witness and tell people about the Lord. Amen. I had a fellow, somewhere, and there was a fellow ahead of me that was using God's name in vain, and every time that he'd say God's name in vain, I'd say, I love you, Jesus. He'd say another bad word, and I'd say, I love you, Jesus. And he looked around at me and said, man, are you crazy? I said, no, but you're talking like you are. And I got to witness to him. But folks, God empowers us to witness. Hallelujah. And he expects us to witness. Oh, God, help us. There was a time, you know, we would pray about everything. I better say it right. When I proposed to my wife, she started to say yes, just like that. I know she did. And I said, no, don't answer me yet. I said, there's going to come a time that I'm going to start pastoring somewhere, and you're going to have to leave this home. This wonderful city of Springfield, Missouri. Thank God we did. But anyway. I've been in a lot of ministerial alliance meetings. Met a lot of ministers from various places and various religions. And the first thing they ask you, well, what school did you go to? I said, I went to school in Springfield, Missouri. Oh, you did? Well, and begin to inquire. And I, I just let them imagine what they wanted to imagine. They thought I went to Evangel or CBC, but I went to Central High School. But we prayed about everything. I told my wife, I said, I'll give you 2 weeks. I want you to pray about it. And that 2 weeks gave me a chance to buy a ring, too. I want you to pray about it. I want you to know it's God's will for your life. And then it come time for us to go into the ministry. And we begin to pray. And God was dealing with us about going into the ministry. And we begin to pray. And I had my pastor come to me and said, Brother, the Lord's dealing with you about going into the ministry. Our state overseer come to me and said, Brother, the Lord's dealing with you about going in the ministry. I said, but I there's a lot of things I need to do and I need to prepare. They said the way you best way you can prepare is get out there and do it. And so I tried. But folks, I want you to know, we prayed about buying cars. We prayed about whether or not we ought to take a new job or not. But nowadays, we just go and do it and hope for the best. But folks, God's still the same yesterday, today, and forever, and He changes not. And God's just as able to direct you to the right car or the right woman or the right job or whatever it might be. God's still on the scene to direct you and give you direction for your life. Amen. One more point. God will give us the power of Pentecost that will enable us to fulfill His work. Well, Brother Long, what is His work? Right here at first. This church. Did you know that God expects you and I to help build this church? Oh, amen. The Bible tells us to go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Paul told Timothy to do the work of an evangelist. It is our responsibility to assist in seeing this church grow. There's an old saying that's been coined, and you've probably heard it a lot. If everybody in this church was just like me, what kind of church would this church be? But folks, let me tell you something. The pastor, as wonderful a pastor we got, they cannot do it by themselves. First church I tried out for in Arkansas, I was about 23 years old, 24. And the deacon board, I'd never had a church that had a deacon board. I always had to do everything myself. But the deacon board said, we want to meet with you after church. And I thought, oh boy. And so I met with that deacon board, and they said, now, brother, what is your plans? What are you going to do if we take you as a pastor, what are you going to do to cause our church to grow? I said, well, first of all, I'm going to work with you, and we're going to cause it to grow together. Amen? Folks, the pastor can't. When I was presbyter, I was area presbyter in this area for a number of years in another area. And I had churches that would be without a pastor. And I'd say, well, what kind of preacher do you want? And they'd say, we want somebody that come in here and cause our church to grow. Well, folks, let me tell you something. While we were pastoring, my wife and I tried everything that is known to man to get a church to grow. We tried gimmicks. I gave away Easter baskets on Easter Sunday. That cost me $100 to put all the candy in. And stood up about that tall. Amen. And we broke records that one Sunday. And we saw people come in. But soon they'd be gone away. Why? Because we can't do it by ourselves. And I had to realize. And I called on God. And I said, God, this thing's bigger than I am. You've got to give me some help. Amen. And God will always send help right on time. There's times that our pastors, I'm going to get points for this, Brother Calhoun. Thank you. But seriously, folks, there's times our pastors needs us to hold their hands as Aaron and Hur did Moses and pray for them. Folks, unless you're pastored, you don't know what you don't know what you're missing. Unless you're pastored, you don't know what a pastor goes through. Amen? They're stressed in being a pastor. They're stressed in being a pastor's wife. They're stressed on every hand. And there's times that they go sleepless nights. There's times that they go days without eating. There's times that the pastor spend all night in prayer just to prepare a message for us on Sunday morning. Amen. But there's times that he needs somebody. Sometimes he looks the pastor looks around. I don't know about Brother Calhoun necessarily, but I know how pastors are. And there's times the pastors have looked around and tried to find somebody that they could talk to, somebody that they could lean on, and there was nobody there. But God help us. That every time we pray, we call our pastor's name in prayer and ask God to give them the strength that they need. That, amen. Because let me tell you something. There's not a battle that you fight that your pastor don't fight with you. There's not a problem that you don't have that your pastor don't have foot with you. Amen. He goes through the sicknesses with you. He goes through your trials with you. And we just need to hold them up in prayer. And every once in a while, walk by and tell them, brother, that was a good message you preached today. Walk by and say, brother, I'm so glad you're my pastor. Sister Calhoun, you're just a wonderful pastor's wife. Encourage them in some way. Every once in a while, whether it's Pastor Appreciation Month or not, take them out and buy them a good steak. I said that preaching revival one time, and you know, some people talk out loud and they don't know it. And I said, folks, you ought to take your pastor out to eat T-bone steak. Lay sitting on the front row said, bless God, I eat bologna and he's no better than I am. I said, well, take him out to eat bologna then. Your deacon board can't cause this church to grow by themselves. I don't know who the deacons are. I know Brother Bob and Brother Marvin. Brother, I don't know who y'all are, but the deacon board, they can't organize enough to make this church grow. You know why? It takes the moving of the Spirit of God, and it takes you and I binding together in prayer. Oh, the pastor just not my cup of tea. Well, pray for him, and he'll be your cup of tea. Amen. But folks, I tell you, God help us that we take on the responsibility and feel like that it's our responsibility to see the church grow. We can't do it by ourselves. We can't magically snap your fingers and people just come running in. I never forget the first church I had. It'd been closed down for 2 years. And they appointed me pastor there. The town had about 300 people in it. And that little church sat out there, and I repainted the sign the best I could, and I put that sign up, and I just knew that when I walked in them, I went back to Springfield and got my younger brothers, and I said, I want you to come and spend a few days with me. And when we got there, I said, I got a job we need to do. We need to clean the church. And so I got them to help me clean up the church. My wife and I worked. And we went to church that first Sunday morning. And I just knew there'd be a house full. Because after all, I was there to pastor. But I came there, and there was nobody there but me and my wife and my daughter. And then the next Sunday, we had one elderly gentleman, 86 years old, and almost deaf. But the old folks, we put our best into that work and realized that it wasn't by our own ability, but God had told Zechariah, go tell Zerubbabel when he began to rebuild the temple, it's not by might nor by power, but it's by my spirit. Folks, we need the power of Pentecost. Brother Stubbs, I appreciate the songs that you sang this morning. Man, I had goosebumps up and down my neck before the first song was over with. I could feel the power of Pentecost, and I appreciate that today. Folks, we need to see the power of God move in our church as never before. Amen. We need the gifts of the Spirit operating in our church. Huh? Oh, I know we've got sophisticated, but we need the gift. We can't, you know, we need the gifts of the Spirit. Word of wisdom, word of knowledge, faith, gifts of healing, working of miracles, prophecy, discerning of spirits, diverse kind of tongues, in other words, speaking in tongues, the interpretation of tongues are the nine gifts of the Spirit. But all these worketh that one and self same Spirit, dividing to every man severally as God will. Amen. We need the move of the Spirit in the church. If there's anything you need to pray about, is God help us to see a move of the Spirit. God help us to see revival spring out in our church. And you're not going to get revival just because you're here. You're going to get revival because we fall on our face before God and wait until the revival comes. When we begin to see the Spirit begin to move, I know that when I received the Holy Ghost, I had prayed every service for almost a year or over a year, asking God to baptize me in the Holy Ghost. And one Sunday I got so hungry, nobody was home but me, and I went home, and I just knelt down beside my bed, and I said, God, I'm not getting up until you baptize me in the Holy Ghost. And I prayed and I prayed and I prayed and I prayed some more. And after a while, I began to sing, I surrender all. I was there by myself so I could sing. And I began to sing, I surrender all. And after a while, I began to pray that song. And I began to pray, God, I surrender everything to you. And after a while, I got lost in the Spirit. And the Holy Ghost came, and before I knew it, I began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave utterance, and I knew that God had baptized me. I got ready for church. We lived 2 miles from church. I ran the whole 2 miles. Of course, I was 15 then. I was running track in high school. But I ran the whole 2 miles. Got to church and wasn't so at church. Huh. I didn't have a watch. And so I went, knew where the youth leader lived, and the pastor wasn't even at his house. So I went down to the youth leader, and my sister was staying with the youth leader, and I knocked on the door, and I said, how come there's nobody at church? They said, because it's 1 o'clock in the afternoon. But God, he not only gave me a spirit of tongues, but he endued me with power from on high. And there's been times that if it wasn't for the power of God, I couldn't have made it. There's been trials. There's been valleys I've had to go through. If it wasn't for the hand of God, I wouldn't have made it. I'm telling you, I thank God. Huh? I can tell you some stories. There's some things that I faced I never thought I'd ever face, but God brought me through. And God give me victory, all because of the power of His Spirit. You shall receive. There is power in Pentecost. There is power in the Holy Ghost. And God wants to baptize you and minister with the group come. God wants to fill you. If you're not full of the Holy Ghost this morning, it's time that you begin to pray. Well, Brother Long, I don't know about the Holy Ghost. Well, just begin to pray, God, if it's for me. I remember one time in our home church, we had a young man come in, sat on the back seat. The altar call was given, and he came to the altar. Myself and some other men and the pastor knelt down with him, and the pastor began to talk to him and lead him in a sinner's prayer. And about the time he got through praying the sinner's prayer, somebody over here began to speak in tongues. And he stopped. And he looked over. And he looked back at me and the pastor like, what's that? And he shut his eyes. I'll never forget it. He throwed up his hands and he said, God, I don't know what that is, but if it's for me, give it to me. And he began to cry out to the Lord. Tears began to once again crease his cheeks. And after a while, God began to minister to him, and the Holy Ghost fell. I had a man one time that wasn't a Christian. He wouldn't even come to church, and he had a problem. His house burnt while he's on vacation, and the church began to try to help him, and I began to try to be a friend to him, and eventually led him to the Lord. But he said, I just don't know about that Holy Ghost. He was in revival, and he was sitting back at the back, and there's a young lady there begin to pray, and she raised her hands, and she began to pray, and God began to minister to her. And after service, he said, Brother Long, I know there's a Holy Ghost Spirit. I said, how do you know? He said, I seen the Holy Ghost like a dove come down and sit on that lady's head, and then she began to talk in a language I couldn't understand. Folks, the Holy Ghost is real. But he will give you power. He's the third person of the Trinity, but he will give you the power to be able to stand against anything the devil will bring your way. Amen. If you need, you can begin to pray. And you can begin to seek God, and you can ask him to fill you full. And don't quit praying. Oh, you may have to get up and go to work. You may have to get up and go about your daily chores or whatever. But every time you pray, go through the day praying and seeking God. Lord, if this is for me, I need your presence. I need your power. Church, we, as I said in the beginning, if we knew what was coming down the road that was going to come against the church, we'd be trying to fill this place full. We'd be seeking God night and day. Amen? That first church I told you about that I pastored in Arkansas, they didn't have locks on the doors. I said, hey, where's the keys to... They said, we don't even have locks on the doors. I said, why not? They said, this church was built during the Depression for a place for people to come and pray. And said, by the time we got the walls up, people would come here, sometimes spend all night in prayer. They wasn't praying about buying a new car. They were praying that God would give them bread for the family. They were praying that God would make a way. Amen. Oh, The Bible said, "My God shall supply all your needs according to His riches in glory." And they were seeking God. And they said, "We want this church to stay open." I don't know if they lock them now, but we want this church to stay open. If anybody wants to come and pray, they can come. They know that it's open, and they can pray anytime, night or day. And there was people that would come and fall on their face and begin to pray. And see, every once in a while, I'd go over to the church for some reason, and I'd hear somebody in there praying, seeking God about a matter. Sometimes I'd go in and pray with them. Sometimes I'd just back out and leave them alone and let them seek God. Folks, it's time that we pray more than just dinner time. It's time that we seek God. Because we're going to face things. The end is coming. Jesus is coming soon. And the closer we get to the coming of the Lord, the more we're going to face. And we need the power of Pentecost. I'm sorry, we're 4-5 minutes over. We need the power of Pentecost as never before. Let's bow our head. Let's begin to pray. Father, I thank you for this service today. I pray, God, that I've said something that has touched some heart or some life. God, I pray that you speak to our hearts. Help us to grow deeper in you. Bless this people, I pray, in Jesus' name. Let's all stand. Let's find us a place to pray. I know it's past 12 o'clock. But let's find us a place to pray. Let's talk to God for a while. Will you come? Find you a place to pray. Let's seek the Lord while we have faith.
I need your presence, Lord, more than anything I've needed before. I need your presence. Only you can give. I anything I've needed before. I need your presence, Lord. I'm filled this house. My soul is hungry, Lord, for the bread that only you can give. I need your Spirit, Lord, pour out on me.
Sing this with us one more time, would you?
I need your presence, Lord, more than anything I've needed before. I need your presence, Lord. I'm filled this
this morning. I didn't know that I'd be closing this service. I didn't know that I'd be doing several things today. Getting under conviction. But Brother Long's good at that. So about 4 minutes ago, I prayed and asked God, I said, how am I supposed to close this service? He said, I'll show you. So I want y'all to stand up. And see those words up there? That needs to be our prayer. That needs to be our prayer today. It's no accident that they sang that chorus. So I'm going to lead you in that prayer. And we're going to say it as a prayer. And I want you to mean it. And you're not saying it because I'm leading you. You're saying it to the Lord. And that's the way we're going to close this service. So if you will, I need your presence, Lord, more than anything I've needed before. I need your presence, Lord. Come fill this house. My soul is hungry, Lord, for the bread that only you can give. I need your Spirit, Lord, poured out on me. And how do we always end our prayers? Amen. Lord, let it be so. Let it be that way. Father, we thank you that you showed up again, that your Holy Spirit was here on the day of Pentecost. Thank you, Lord, for anointing Brother Long to bring to us what he brought, the very oracles of a loving God. Be with us today as we go our way, God. And bring us back at the appointed time to continue this worship. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Love on somebody before you go.